Thank you. You may be seated. The last few years, the ride has been very bumpy, but it's been good. And I think that my biggest concern in coming to this meeting is that somehow I'm not portrayed as a hero or anybody special or having some enablement or ability or acumen that others don't have, because I'm convinced that if there's anything that proves the grace of God, it's my life. And that the Lord is he's able to use people who will show up part of the time and are faithful on occasion. And that's the way I've qualified so far and to date. I think I have intention this week of talking a little bit about revival. And at some point I want to talk about, from pastor to pastor, I want to talk a little bit about the basic problem of insecurity, because I see that as, I've been asked to bring a word, and that's what I see as a major, major problem in the church today. But I think that in order to kind of segue from what I've been hearing and maybe to demythologize my role as a pastor and someone who is himself in transition, I think it would be good to take a few minutes to sort of introduce myself. You know, how do you get a John Wimber? And what's the process? And what are the things that guide me and that are important to me? And it's of course is a number of circumstances that have to do with encounters with God and also with encounters with men, the things that have shaped and formed me, information. Circumstances that have been providentially brought about that have given me the viewpoints that I've had. Maybe by way of introduction, I could say this, that I was converted at 28 years old. I was a rock and roll musician, had a group called the Righteous Brothers, and we had some hit records, and I had had hit records with other groups, but that was the group I was with when I got converted. And I was converted into a little Quaker church in Southern California. This church would have been typical to most Nazarene or Wesleyan churches. It was Armenian Wesleyan kind of theology, holiness church. It was a quaint little church in a quaint little community. And I didn't know one church from another. I'd never been in one. I didn't have any concept. I was totally pagan. I was out of the pagan pool from pagan Anaheim right next to pagan Disneyland. So I didn't have a concept of church. I remember once, I was a Second World War kid. I grew up during that era. And I remember one time riding my bicycle along a street in Anaheim called Broadway, and there was churches along that street. And I turned and came down Santa Ana Street, and there was a little Pentecostal church there. I learned that later. But I didn't know Pentecostal from Baptist or anything else in those days. Because when you don't go to church, you don't know the differences between them. And I remember they had a little neon light on the side, and it would flicker on and on. It said, "Jesus saves." And I remember riding my bike. I was about 12 years old at the time, and I thought, I wonder what it is he saves. Because, you know, being a Second World War kid, we saved all kinds of things. We saved rubber bands. We saved, you know, paper. We saved, you know, all kinds of stuff. But I didn't have a clue as to what he saved, and I didn't find it out until I was 28 years old. And somebody asked me one time, "Wait a minute, you grew up in America and you never met a Christian?" And I said, "Well, if I did, he didn't blow his cover in my presence." I didn't have anybody ever tell me about Jesus. And when I was 28, I was introduced to the Lord by a lovely man. He was a welder, and he'd had some tragic circumstances in his life. His daughter had been murdered and raped, and which had given him a lot of notoriety. And as a result of that, he had been driven into the streets to witness and win people to Christ. And he had, by the time I met him, he had won a couple of thousand people one-on-one to Christ using the. He couldn't go anywhere. Everybody knew him because this was a major murder case in Southern California. It was during the early era of television, and so it was carried nightly on the news, sometimes several times a night. for a matter of 6 months or so. It was a very dramatic case. And in fact, Billy Roop, the young man that murdered her, was the last person to die in the gas chamber in California. Which, by the way, the man that led me to the Lord, his name was Gunner Payne. Gunner had led him to the Lord before he died in the gas chamber. But Gunner was a soul winner. You know, he just went door to door and knocked on the door. Everybody recognized him. They had a softness towards him because of the tragedy. And he would come in and tell them all about, they'd want to know about the murder, and he'd tell them all about the Lord. And so in due course of time, we got to know each other, and he led me to the Lord. And he discipled me. Now, he didn't use the word disciple. He didn't know the word disciple. But what he did was he would just say, "Do you want to go with me?" And I just went and did what he did. And pretty soon I could stand like him and spit like him. And I knew all of his favorite verses and all of his favorite stories. And I would say them as he was saying them. Because all he did was basically essentially the same thing. He would just go from house to house and talk to people about Jesus. And so we would make appointments, kind of like insurance salesmen. And so when I remember on occasion, he had a son that had a tragic accident. The man's had all kinds of tragedy in his life. And I keep talking into this microphone. I forget that I have this one on. He had all kinds of tragedy in his life. And it was interesting to me that that often men that are mightily used of God, and he has been, do have a great deal of tragedy in their lives. It's interesting that that's not only true in the scripture, but it's true, today. I sat countless hours that first year in homes and listened to him answer some questions, you know, some of the most obscure questions. And he'd say, "Well, over here in Amos it says, and back here," and that's how I got through the Bible for the first time. And so approximately a year into this process, he had to move away. And he basically handed off to me, and so I had a ministry of soul winning and Bible study leading. And it wasn't really Bible study because, well, I didn't know the Bible. I knew the first three chapters of the Gospel of John, and then I was dead in the water, you know, and I didn't know those that well. So it really didn't matter what question they asked me. I answered the first three three chapters of the Gospel of John. And I had an interesting homiletic and hermeneutic, for that matter. If I didn't know the answer, I just made something up. And pretty soon, the people that started getting wise, you know, to that, and they said, "Well, wait a minute, that's not right." And they'd say, "Oh, well, over here it says." And I said, "Well, if you knew it, why didn't you answer it?" And so pretty soon, they started bringing their Bible aids and their, you know, stuff with them, and we legitimately got into studying the Bible together, but just to keep me honest. But, you know, it's silly, and it's, you know, funny looking back on it, but it worked. I led several hundred, perhaps a couple of thousand people to the Lord in a 3 or 4 year period. Because I was so visible in Orange County as a musician, I'd been there a long time, and I was kind of in rock and roll, one of the early pioneers, and had a major group, and so I had a lot of visibility. And that became an entree to talking to a lot of people about Jesus. Now, while this process was going on, I was being introduced to church life, and I found church life to be a lot different than what I had anticipated. I can remember the first few weeks. I had gone to Bible study in this home, a friend's home, for 3 or 4 months before I went to the church for the first time. And by then, I, being a pagan, I didn't even know God had a book out, so I didn't know that there was an Old Testament or a New Testament. I didn't have any concept, you know. So when they told me the new part was 2,000 years old, I couldn't believe it. And I remember starting to read it, and I found out it was all about Jewish people. Did you know that? I didn't know God was Jewish, and it was so strange, you know, because in the music industry and in television and movies where I had worked, I worked with lots of Jewish people. So one of my biggest difficulties before I got converted is every time I'd picture Jesus, I would picture a little haberdasher with a cigar in his mouth, you know, making a deal, you know, a jeweler, you know, with a thing in his eye or something like that, you know. Not exactly, you know, your classic view of Christ. So anyway, I got converted in this process, and I got discipled, along this process, I had read the Gospels a number of times, and I just fell in love with Jesus. I was so excited about him. I just loved the stuff he did. Do you like that stuff? Me too. I just love it. I liked it when he, you know, made the multiplied the fishes and the loaves. Didn't you like that part? And when he walked on the water, was that hot? I got a theory about walking on water. You have to do it very fast. Anyway, I just loved him. And so I didn't know what they did at these churches, and they kept saying, come to church with us, come to church with us. So finally, you know, one time we went. And what I had in mind after reading the Gospels was that all these people would come to this building, they would sort of pray a little bit and talk, you know, rev each other up and talk about it, and then sort of divvy up the turf. And then everybody would hit the streets, and they'd go out and multiply a few fishes and loaves and heal the sick and cast out a demon or two and win the lost, and then come back at church and meet in the afternoon. So now, you know, you're looking at me like, no, that's actually what I expected to happen. So I went there the first week and ready to go. And we got in there, you know, it was a building, something like this. We all kind of got seated and everything. And they did this, and they did this, and then they did this, and then they did this. But no fish, you know. No loaves, no demons, you know. Afterwards, I went to this friend of mine who had invited me, and I said, did they have a bye today or what? I mean, what happened? He says, what do you mean? And Carol grabbed my sleeve and said, come on, you know, don't be doing it. You're a troublemaker. And all we knew how to do in those days was fight and make children. And we finally quit doing both. So I went home, and she couldn't talk me into going back for 2 or 3 weeks. And then finally I said, okay, I'll go, but I'm only going to go if they're going to go do it. So we went back there, and they didn't do it. It's the same stuff that they did the time before. So afterwards, I went out on the front lawn. They had a front lawn there where everybody sort of stood around and talked afterwards. And this guy had a badge, you know, on this. Now, he looked important. So I went up and grabbed his sleeve, and I said, excuse me. And he said, yes. He was tall. He was bigger than mine. And I said, excuse me. And he said, yes. And I said, when do they do it? And he said, do what? I said, you know, the stuff in the book. He said, what stuff? I said, you know, the stuff, this stuff here, like sight to the blind, the deaf, you know, those kind of people, dumb, that kind of stuff, you know, walking stuff, you know, the healing stuff, the stuff that they do in the book. And he said, he looked at me like I had two heads, and he says, oh, we don't do it. I said, what? I said, you don't do it? And he says, no, we don't do it. And I said, wait a minute, let me get this straight. I said, I gave up drugs for this. You're telling me they don't do it? He says, no. He says, sometimes we sing about it. So I went and got in the car, and my wife and I had an argument all the way home. And I said, what's the use? I mean, when I worked for the devil, he let me do his stuff. Now I'm working for Jesus, I want to do his stuff. And see, I didn't know that anybody did his stuff. And in fact, what I was taught early on was that nobody was doing it better than they were. And in fact, this was sort of the premier group. Now, nobody ever used that language, but it was the attitude. And, you know, we would talk bad about this group and bad about that group every now and then, and cut this group up and this doctrine down. And, You know, and this, when we were the group, and I remember looking around and thinking, boy, Lord, you're in trouble. If this is the group, you know, because this group is going out of business, because, and it was. It was shrinking all the time. And I'd been in business for a long time, and I knew about business. I, if there's anything I understood, was business. I've owned and operated now, I think, 61 businesses in my life. And I understand business. I know all about business. And our business was bad. You know? We were not doing good. And I remember going to the pastor and telling him, you know, one day I said, what do you have in mind? What are you trying to accomplish? And he gave me the most startled look, you know. And I found out after about an hour and a half of listening to him that what he had in mind was just keeping on, you know, just doing it was enough. You know, just doing, having the meetings and keeping the calendar and baptizing a child now and then and, you know, doing this or doing, marrying somebody, burying somebody. And I thought, there's got to be more to it than this. Well, over the next few months and years, you know, a number of things happened to me. I had some encounters with the Lord, and I ended up in Bible school and seminary. And early on, I should tell you this, I had an experience, the Pentecostals called Baptism in the Holy Spirit, and spoke in tongues, and that without, I'd never read Acts or Corinthians or Romans even at that point. And so I don't know what in the world was going on with me. I went home and told my wife, and she said the devil had me. And I said, I don't understand that because, I mean, how could the devil have me? I've been so good. And she says, all I know, and she brought out this little book she got from this radio preacher, and sure enough, the devil had me. So we went down and talked to the to the pastor, and she made me show him that I could do it, what I could do. Listen to this, she said, and so I did it. And he said, sure enough, the devil had me. And I said, well, I don't understand how the devil got me. I said, I'm not sinning, I'm not doing bad, I don't, how did the devil get me? And he said, well, your problem is you don't have sound doctrine. If you had sound doctrine, these things wouldn't happen to you. And he sent me off to Bible college, and I got sound doctrine, and you know, he was a true prophet. Because the sounder I got, the less of those things happened to me. You know? And so, about a 12-year period went on. During that time, I was faithful to continue to do personal evangelism and start small groups and things, and that was a wonderful era, a period of my life. A very productive period. It was set during a portion of the Jesus People revival, and in those days in Orange County, you could practically sneeze people into heaven, and it was just wonderful to lead people to Christ. And though I wasn't working with the hippie element, I was still having my impact, and it was a wonderful, and I don't want to in any way cheapen the Lord's participation in my life. It was wonderful. But I, there was an impugning dynamic in that I was being told that one aspect of my Christian endeavor was, you know, inappropriate and wrong. And somehow a psychological quirk or a false teaching or the devil had me or some other. And I remember every now and then driving home from seminary and I'd check to see if the devil still had me. I've always been a little bit of a rebel, you know, just a tinge. And I'd check, and sure enough, he still had me. And I think, boy, you know, he really holds on once he gets a grip, you know, in some area of your life. I just simply couldn't handle the ever-increasing residual group of people that just didn't make it in that kind of system. I know now that some of them were demonized and others were having other kinds of problems, but they just kept falling through the cracks, and it was breaking my heart to see people that I sometimes gave countless hours to just unable to overcome, unable to function in a system that really didn't recognize the enemy's power much and didn't recognize sin in the way that I think it. I now recognize it, and some other things. And at the same time, I want you to know that the people I worked with there were godly people, wonderful people. I owe much of my foundation and understanding to them. And with just a few points of departure, I'm much the same as they are today. In the aftermath of that, I had planted a lot of churches as a byproduct of small groups, and that became known, and Fuller Seminary approached me and asked me to pioneer a department of church growth called the Fuller Evangelistic Association, and it was a consultative arm that worked with denominations and parachurch organizations. So between 1975 and or 74 and 78, I worked with 27 denominations and 9 parachurch organizations, and as a church growth advocate, I still am. People ask me today, do you still believe in church growth? I do. The only proviso is that, I didn't believe it then. I used to say, I'm a thoroughgoing church growth advocate except for two things. One is I do not think anything you learn from church growth can grow a church. Only God can grow a church. I always believe that, and so that's not inconsistent at all. And furthermore, that the assumption that learning these things will somehow give you control or ability to manipulate growth, and I don't believe either one of those things. I didn't believe it then. I don't believe it now. But beyond that, I really don't have any problem with church growth. Not everything that's called church growth is church growth. But generic church growth teaching is simply reporting. It's reporting what God's doing around the world, and in such a way as that it ought to be helpful to help you discern what he may be doing, maybe at an embryonic level, in your midst and in your group. Probably the two most important things that happened to me at seminary, is other than my not graduating. One is I was introduced to George Elton Ladd. First time I ever met him, he found a sandwich in his pocket that had been there for 4 days. He was a classic absent-minded professor type, you know. He literally did. He reached it. He says, oh, there that is, you know. It happened to be a tuna sandwich. I'll never forget George. But he introduced to me the teaching of the kingdom of God. Frankly, it became the very foundation of everything that I do. It gave me the integrating theme that made the Bible make sense to me. Up until then, I had been trained as a dispensationalist, whereas I haven't really left dispensationalism as a whole, I've left one aspect of it, cessationism, which, of course, you wouldn't agree with. But I was introduced to and thought that it was true. I thought that all the gifts had died out at the end of the apostolic age. So that was one of the things I was indoctrinated in to get sound doctrine, so I wouldn't speak in tongues any longer. So being introduced to George was profoundly important. And then one day I was sitting out on the mall eating a sandwich, and I was reading in the speed reading, actually, the Gospel of John. And I came to the 14th chapter, and I was reading through, and if you'll turn there with me, I want to share 3 or 4 verses that tell you the core of what I'm all about. This is Jesus speaking. He's having this interaction with Philip. Philip has said, Lord, show us the Father. Jesus answered, don't you know me, Philip, even after I've been among you such a long time or with you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father, then the Father is in me? The words I say to you are not just my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. 11th verse. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. Now what he's saying here is very logical within a Hebraic mindset. He's saying, if you can't believe my testimony, believe that testifies of me, which is the miraculous, and gives evidence to the fact, pointing in this case to his divinity, as well as to the undergirding and the backing up and blessing of his Father. And then he says this incredible statement, I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. Now, when you learn scripture under a teacher, they tell you what it does mean and doesn't mean. And once you've been taught that, you have what we would call paradigms, viewpoints, understandings. And I had been taught what this doesn't mean, which is what it obviously says it does mean. That controlled the way I viewed the text. Now, I don't know if it was my apple, or the sunlight, or the fact I was reading a New American Standard, or what, but I came to this text and I heard it like it was resounding in my head. I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. And it was like an explosion in my face. And then I read on, he will do even greater things than these because I'm going to the Father. Now, at the time that I read the text, I had been taught that, of course, Jesus didn't mean even greater things. And I, you know, there aren't many commentaries or theological writings that you can find today that would support what I think we have in common in our belief, and that is the understanding that it is in God's intention and is here being prophesied by his Son, which the book Revelation tells us in whom the spirit of prophecy, you know, is, as its full being, as it were. And he's prophesying about a time, I believe, yet to come in which the church will literally do greater things than Jesus did. Now, I had been taught, as I said, not to believe that, but that day, it was just like an explosion in my face. And texts came to mind that might otherwise seem a little obscure. For instance, there's a sort of a transitory news brief found in the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. Let me read this to you, and I'm going to dramatize it as I have in other places by reading it as a newscaster, because I think it helps contemporize it. This is the fourth chapter of Matthew, the 23rd verse. I'm reading it out of the NIV, which is necessary in Vineyard. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. News about him spread all over Syria, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. Large crowds from Galilee, the Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and the region across the Jordan followed him. More at 11 o'clock. This little passage, along with one found in the ninth chapter of Matthew, are like bookends on the outside of the Galilean campaign. And they clearly state that the characteristics of the ministry of Jesus was done both in the doing and the telling. This is what Luke catches in the first chapter of the book of Acts. Let's look at that for a second. In his writings, he says this, in my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to what? And to what? To do and to teach. Now, it was the marrying of these two ideas that formulated my whole theology, at least as it relates to ministry. You see, the message of Jesus was contained not only in the words, but also in the works. Now, I believe that we can be converted, as it were, outside of a direct interaction with Scripture. But I don't think we'll be fully converted until we know the Scripture and the Scripture knows us. I think conversion is a process as well as an event. And that we need to, as it were, have our minds come under the tutelage of the Scripture. Now, I know that there's theological tensions with that, but I think I can defend myself ably in this particular area. So I see the Word of God as the message of God, but I also see the works of God as the message of God. That is to say, the Word of God gives you the illumination, but the works of God give you the illustration. The illumination without the illustration is an incomplete message. And in this century, the phenomenon of the Pentecostal, Charismatic, and now Third Wave movement has married those two ideas to the extent that it has impacted the church the world over. And we have various and sundry numbers summarizing the total at the present time. It ranges everything from $327 million to $372 million. I don't know if those two numbers have been turned around. But there's no question about it that the most incredible move of God in all the history of redemption is going on today, worldwide, and it's inculcated in the Pentecostal, charismatic, and now third wave aspects of the work of God. And so, if there's anything that I felt that I had got a hold of, I got a grasp of, and remember this was back in 1985, and at that time we didn't have, Dr. Barrett hadn't published, and we didn't have some of the information we now have concerning the rapid growth of the Pentecostal charismatic influence. And so when God spoke to me so clearly and so plainly, it set me off, like my grandpa used to say, like a scalded dog, trying to work it out. And I remember writing down, I had a New American Standard with a large, border. And I wrote down, I must learn, next to John 14, 12, I must learn to believe what Jesus believed and do what Jesus did. Now, since that time, and frankly, if you want to know what I'm about, that's it. I'm still working on John 14, 12. I haven't ever got to 14, 13 yet. I'm still trying to work out, and my understanding is it comes out of, the core of it comes out of intimacy with Christ, which is what Jesus was saying to Philip when he said he is in the Father and the Father is in me. And so the two very important understandings that I have is one, that I've been called as a member of the body of Christ to work out in some practical way an evidential Christianity that is more than just a good idea, more than just a good philosophical framework for working out your life and its derivatives. It is a Christian experience, an experience with God that can be evidenced from day to day and place to place among all people, that transcends every culture, every language, and every division that the enemy has been able to bolster or develop from that day to this. That's the kind of Christianity that I want to work with and work in. And along the way, God spoke to me and gave me a directive. And that directive basically is he told me to go home to Anaheim and plant a church. And I'm still there, and we're still in that process. God called me at home to plant a church. But the difficulty is he's really given me three basic jobs. And one of the jobs has to do with pastoring a church. Another is fostering and fathering a movement. And probably therein is that's been the most difficult part of my pilgrimage the last 10 years. The movement has grown rapidly, and I don't know if it was false humility or real humility, but I had difficulty believing that God really wanted me to take those churches seriously. And it's only been as a direct encounter with Paul Kane, and in which he called me to account in the name of the Lord for my fathering, that I've really taken seriously the role of spiritual father. And I want to go on record as saying that there have been a number of helps and aids, not the least of which was Ernie Gruen. He's helped me too in that regard. And so I'm taking seriously the role of fathering the churches now for the first time, and I give more time to it. But the Lord told me a long time ago, he gave me a third job, and he gave that to me out of Matthew 10. You don't need to turn there, but you know that's where Jesus sent out the 12, and he called them by name, and he gave them an express and specific job to do, and he told them to go not to the Gentiles, but to the house of Israel, and told them to preach this message, the message of the kingdom, and he told them to heal the sick, cast out demons, and raise the dead. Now the Lord took that text a number of years ago, and I know that this is an allegorical hermeneutic, whereas I don't believe you can use them for teaching, I do believe that God uses them for speaking to his children. I think there's ample illustration of that in the scripture, where God abuses Old Testament, Jesus himself abuses the meaning of Old Testament texts to give a new meaning in a New Testament context. And I believe the Holy Spirit still does that. And so the Holy Spirit gave me that text one day in prayer and said, I want you to go to the nations. I want you to go basically to the Western nations, and I want you to arouse them, excite them, make them mad at you. He didn't tell me that. He just said, I want you to go and preach this gospel to the kingdom. And I said, where? And he says, to the house of Israel. And I said, you want me to literally go to Israel? And he said, no, the church. And so he sent me to the church. So a long time ago, he made a bargain with me. My understanding of the bargain is if I will give 9/10 of my time, travel time, to working in his church, he will, in effect, grow mine. And that's been our agreement. So that's the way, that's the division of labor. I go out and do meetings such as this, you know, working transdenominationally. Of all the weeks that I'm gone, at 9/10 of the time I give to this kind of thing, 1/10 of the time I give to the movement, the rest of the time I spend home. And the Lord has blessed, and it's been wonderful, and I'm grateful for it. He also told me some time ago to be a change agent. And for 16 years now, I've been teaching in the doctoral program at Fuller. Some people think that I was fired at Fuller. I've never been fired. I have all the work I want, and more than I want. And during that time, I've been teaching on being a change agent, but I'm teaching primarily there as well as in the meetings that I go out to. I mentioned a moment ago that we've had about 400,000, it's approaching 400,000 people in our meetings. They're mainly leaders. About 85% are professionals that come to those meetings. 63% of them are pastors and or pastors' wives. So we're talking to professional people. Only 2% of them are Pentecostals, about 6% are charismatics, and the rest of them are mainline church people, largely conservative evangelicals. And so God has given me a target audience, a group that he wants me to talk to. And this is the non-tongue speaking portion of the evangelical strata. And my job to them is to go and tell them that they need to speak in tongues. No. Well, my job is to go tell them that you don't have to leave your mind at home to get your tongue to work. Or something like that. And to preach the kingdom of God to them and to get them to expand their horizons and their understandings. And as I have prayed over it and worked with it and analyzed it, I think the main problem that I'm dealing with there as I go to the conservative evangelical church is that they are theologically theists, but in practice, deists. And what I'm dealing with is, and assaulting again and again and again, is a perception of the work of God vis-a-vis the Holy Spirit that distances him and does not anticipate or expect his present action or presence today. Now that is not the problem in this room. That's not my analysis of you and or of Pentecostalism generally. I think Pentecostalism has some other problems, and if you want to pay me a lot of money and get me a screen here where I can stand behind it, I'll tell you what your problems are someday. And so my job has been to go out and talk to a group of people, and remember Bob talked about how to wake a sleeping dog. I go out and talk to a group of people who are, by and large, believe they're right about everything. They're right, and they know they're right, and we are right. And when you're right, you don't need any help or you know, counsel or work, and you just, let's just affirm how right we are by telling everybody how wrong everyone else is. And that's a kind of a cyclical process in which they swirl in their reasoning. We've come to a place of liberal thinking through interaction with what is called a higher criticism. In the Anglican circles, he would have difficulty with any number of cardinal doctrines concerning Christ, his birth, and his ascension, that type of thing, resurrection. And then depending on which circle you're in, whether it's in Lutheranism or in Presbyterianism, for them. If you study church growth, as I have and still do, you'll know that there's been a continual out-migration for 40 years now. And when you study the decline of Presbyterianism and Methodism and Episcopalianism and other church systems here in the United States, and wherever we see an adherence to and a commitment to the inerrancy of Scripture and the infallibility of Scripture and a substantial commitment to the cardinal doctrines of the past, you'll see a more solidarity and more substantial church life. But wherever you see them vacillating, it's just almost destroyed the church. And so America's changing. Advancing pluralism has set in. And throughout the South, we've had major changes in communities. And there's been a number of studies showing the interaction between groups. And so on the one hand, there's the larger milieu of what's happening in the nation, but on the other hand, there's that's coming up through the nation, such as what we call the baby boomers. And somebody was talking to me at lunch about, you know, the baby boomers, and I minister to the baby boomers. And in fact, I've heard two people say this since I got here last night, how with sort of an enviable sound in her voice, gee, isn't it wonderful to be on the cutting edge of working with the baby boomers? Hey, it's not so hot. The baby boomers are hard to minister to. It's very important that you understand the baby boomers are entrenched in rebellion and witchcraft. It's widespread, and the manipulation of themselves, self-exploitation, they're very mobile. They change and fluctuate, and you know, so you have to do it on the run. You know, hey, I got one more thing I want to tell you about Jesus. And so somebody said, well, you know, are you discipling your people there at the Vineyard? And I said, I don't know. I watch them come in the front door. I watch them go out the back door. How much discipling can you get in a half an hour, you know? I don't know. It's hard work to disciple them. But we, you know, we catch a core, and we are growing. And by every standard that I know of, in terms of measurement, we're processing them well. And keep in mind, the New Testament, we have the images of fishing and farming. I said I was converted in 1963 into a church that was really about 25 years out of phase with the culture. I mean, you could have walked in there in 1940 and heard the same music. The cars would have been a little different in the parking lot, but they would have been mainly Chevys. And the clothes, they looked the same. They were still getting them at J.C. Penney's. And but as far as the music and the way they preached and the way they interacted together, they were at least 25 years out of phase with the rest of the culture. Keep in mind that the church system, being a microcosm of the larger culture, is in itself culture retardant. It's resistant. It does not change at the rate that the rest of the culture does. Now, that's one of the values, in that it helps us, as it were, keep the faith. But one of the negatives is that it helps, it deters the rate at which we can share the faith. Because we don't look like, act like, talk like the people we're trying to witness to and relate to. And they see that very clearly, and we can't see it nearly as clearly as they can see it. But you know, when in reverse, you know, most of you would know many of the churches in the community, but you probably don't know all the beer bars, I hope. And but those that frequent beer bars, they know all the different beer bars and when you can get the cheapest beer at the right time and get the most beer or the quality beer or the waitress that's the better looking. And they know all about it. They can tell you all the pros and cons of where to go, in much the same way you could the churches that you might attend, because you're a consumer. You use churches. You go to churches. You understand churches. And so those that frequent other places, they see clearly the distinctions. You know, when you go into a mall, and we have them across the country now, and you know, my daughter, she likes to dress me. It's a thing. I don't know why she's taking it on. I think she thinks I'm looking very old. Which, by the way, does anyone here know my wife, Carol? Would you raise your hand? Four or five of you do? Oh, Danny, hi. Don't tell her I got up here with a wrinkled shirt, will you, when you see her? Nothing makes her madder. I forgot to change shirts. So my daughter, she's been buying my clothes lately. Now, when we go into the mall, there's four or five stores that I recognize instantly as my kind of stores, right? I mean, I can tell by the clothes they've got out in the front window. I can tell by the music that's not playing when I walk in the door. I can tell by the age of the men and women serving us. that it's my kind of store. That's not the kind of store she wants to go into to get me clothes. She wants to go into these places where the lights are blowing, rock and roll, and the noise. And I'm saying, Stephanie, you don't understand. I'm 57 years of age, and I like it. And I'd like to dress 67. I don't want to dress 27. And so we have these little dialogues. And so a number of years ago, when the Lord gave me an opportunity to start a church. Now, I don't want to in any way sound like I thought this thing all up, because believe me, the Lord, he had to wrestle me down to get this church started. And I mean, he spoke to me 19 different times in 3 months. And in different ways I was not used to. He spoke to me through a prophetess. I didn't believe in prophecy, much less prophetesses, you know? Dreams, visions. I mean, in our circles, we had 4 ways that God spoke to us. He spoke to us through highlighted scripture, right? God gave me a word today, right? You know that one? Now that was a biggie. That was, you know, number one for us. And if you got that, you were there. And then we had one that was just a slightly more subjective. It was called the burden. You know the burden? Everybody go, ooh. This is a spiritual man, you know? He's got a burden. I don't have a burden, you know? But he's got a burden. I know that man's spiritual because he's got a burden, you know? I mean, it qualified him instantly in our circles. Now, there was one that was sort of in between that. It was not quite so subjective. It was every bit as good, and that was the counsel of your elders. And besides that, your wife said it was okay. And so if you got those two, you're in. You know, if the scripture was highlighted and you got the counsel, you didn't really need a burden. You knew that God was in. Now, the most qualified spiritually was called the open door. It just came together. And boy, whenever that happened, that was a coup de grace. We knew God was alive and working in our circle. Now, I'm saying it in a humorous way, but I want you to know that was it. That was the total thing. And so the kinds of things that happened to the people in the Bible were just not on my horizon. Dreams and visions and people talking to you and angels appearing and stuff like that, you know. Well, God used all those means. One of the first things he used, Larry, was a Lutheran man. Came up to me in a meeting in New York City, and he was very embarrassed. And he said, I don't know, I've never done this before. He's going like that. He says, I've never done this before. He says, but I was sitting there today, and he says, I could be wrong. He says, every time I looked at you, I saw a big Indian. I said, what? He said, I saw an Indian. I mean, I saw an Indian like that. He said, I saw it in a gymnasium. I said, what? And he said, I saw an Indian. Now, I never talked to anyone with a vision before. I think it was his first vision. And he says to me, while you were up there speaking, I could see this, it looked like a gymnasium to me. He said, and I saw this big Indian. And he says, and I know that that's where you're going, and you're going to start a church there. Well, a year and a half later, we move into a gym that was about the size of this, and I'm walking in the door, and I turn, and on the wall, from floor to ceiling, is an Indian. That's the symbol, you know, and so it, you know, authenticated his word. And so God gave me, through a number of unique experiences, leading to start this work. Furthermore, he gave me similar kinds of things for the movement. Furthermore, he gave me similar kinds of things for the work among the churches. And I learned to speak all the buzzwords. You know, I knew how to talk to the Southern Baptists, and I knew how to talk to the GARB. It was, you know, Conference Baptists from the, you know, this group and that group. And but they were all different. I knew 7 different kinds of Mennonites. I learned 3 different kinds of Presbyterians. And each of them had their own language symbols and systems. You know, I remember getting off the plane once in Memphis and meeting a Southern Baptist brother. You know, and the first thing he had, you're washed in the blood, brother. It was Monday morning. His throat was hoarse. He had been preaching hard. And, you know, I'd never heard washed in the blood before. I was a Christian. I was a consultant, you know, but I'm washed in the blood. What's he talking about, you know? But I decided I must be, so I said yes. And that seemed to qualify me. He never asked me another question about my education or training or background for being there and charging him $800 a day as a consultant. And so I discerned that very few people were reaching the boomers. And so the Lord said, go home and start a church. And I said, Lord, can I start it with the boomers? Can I reach young people? And he said, okay, in effect. I got the distinct impression it was okay. And so I said, Lord, what do I have to do? And that's when he started giving me these images of malls and centers. Where do young people go? How do they dress? What's the decimal level for young people? Is over against your comfortable zone, John. And so I realized from all the years of traveling around churches in America that churches are made for people approximately 48 years of age. They're designed for that. The buildings are designed for it, the sound, the color selection, the tones, everything is designed to accommodate people in their mid to late 40s. It's not for 28 years old, it's not for 18 years old. So I said, Lord, if we want me to have a church, where should I have it? And he said, put it in a gymnasium. That's where they're the most comfortable. And so that's where we went. And we stayed there for 5 years. And we grew from a handful of about 50 people to 4,000 in that 5 years. Well, 4 years in the gymnasium. And then we moved from there to a factory, and that didn't seem to bother them too much. So we kept right on growing. I got a long letter the other day. Why aren't we having kinships anymore? And I said, well, because they don't work anymore. You know, we've changed, you know. If you were fishing in a lake and you caught all the bottom fish, would you continue to use the bait and set up for bottom fish? What would you do if you wanted fish? You'd hook up on a different setup, right?
Right.
Not the church. Keep fishing for bottom fish. There ain't no bottom fish. I don't care if there's no bottom fish. I like to set up with this setup. This is the one my daddy used and my granddaddy used. And I'm going to keep on using it.
Amen.
I am speaking to the right group. Because we sanctify our methodology. And I understand that. You know, you get saved in Sunday school, what do you do the rest of your life? You work in Sunday school. You get saved at camp, what do you do the rest of your life? You go to camp. You get saved at a Graham Crusade, what do you do? Huh? It's at your point of entry. Where did you have these occasions with God? And so that gets, you know, you build a little tabernacle. And you camp there, huh? That's biblical, isn't it? But what... What I'm advocating and arguing for is that in the meantime, people are moving on and going to hell every day. We've got to set up to reach them. Now, I'm not advocating that all of you change your churches from the inside out. I think that would be dumb and dysfunctional, harmful. It would be in lack of harmony with God. I think it'd be doing a disservice to Him. I think some minor modifications might help accommodate a larger group than you're now working with, but I'm not in any way encouraging you. In fact, because I've spent so much time working with the church system, when I don't advocate anything that the Vineyard does for the church system. I'm dead serious. It's not for you. You shouldn't use our stuff. You should develop your own. Things that will accommodate you. Now, there's a lot of things that can be done. A few years ago, I was sitting with some Anglicans in central London, and they said, our church is packed to the brim. Now, there are not a lot of Anglican churches that have that problem, but this particular one did. It's Holy Trinity Brompton, central London. They said, our church is packed to the brim. What can we do? And I said, well, let's church plant. We can't church plant. We have the parish system. We can't do that. And I said, are there any redundant churches? Well, yes, there are. I said, go to the Bishop of London, find out how many were. They did. Found out there were 33 redundant churches in the community. Now, the difficulty with their system is even if the church is closed, since it's owned by the state, in effect, it's still under controls of people who have vested interest in keeping that control. You ever heard of a church boss? You have if you've been in the church 5 minutes. Because every church has a church boss or two. And so they had their church bosses, and they had to get around those church bosses, but I know how to do that. I've been doing it for years. And so I just gave them some counsel, and we worked with it and prayed over it. And since that time, they've started, I think they're on their seventh church in central London. They've grown from, about 1,300 to 1,400 people now to almost 5,000 people in central London, building big, healthy, vibrant Anglican churches in the center of one of the largest cities on earth, where you couldn't afford the property to save your life. But by simply getting past the system and doing their job, they're doing their job. A similar situation in an Anglican church in northern England. They had a lot of what we call urban blacks. This doesn't mean people with Afro ancestry. These are people that are white people that dress in black clothes, dye their hair garish colors, and it's often black. They wear all black clothes. They're all over Europe, and nobody to speak of is reaching them. There was a young man in that community named Chris Brain. He came to our meetings. He was a fine musician, very artistic, very gifted, and I could see evangelism all over him. And so we prayed for him, and the Spirit of God put him in seminary for several hours on the floor, flopping like a fish. And he came up, and we said, there's your pastor. Pastor, there's your evangelist. And now they have over 900 of these young people that meet in what they call the 9 o'clock service. And now they're beginning to multiply those churches, churches within churches. These are churches that are reaching a select group of people. Now, the people in the morning don't want to see what those young people do at night. And so the pastor says, don't come around here at night. You won't like it. Because about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they come in and they hang things and this hardly seems like church. Because they have lights and they have photographs and all kinds of media going on and rock and roll music and the drums beat all the way through the service while the preaching's gone, I used to be a rock and roll musician, but I was totally threatened when I was in that service preaching through it. It was hard for me to handle because it's so foreign to my understanding of what it ought to be. But when you see those young people coming forward with the tears running down their faces and saying, Jesus, Jesus, I give you my heart and my life. And you see I've been back now 3 or 4 times and I've watched them, and they're now out evangelizing in the streets and feeding the hungry. And so what I'm saying is that you need to begin looking at the harvest that's around you. You know the harvest that the Lord is preparing in America today? It's the harvest of the poor. Multiple millions of them. Multiple millions of them. It's a great harvest. Not too long ago, I was praying for them, and the Lord, I said, Lord, how, I want to see the harvest. I've been praying out of Matthew 9:36, and he said, I want to see the harvest. And he took me to Matthew 5 and showed me the Beatitudes, and he says, that's the harvest. The poor in spirit, blessed are those that are meek, blessed are, and I said, Lord, what's it look like? And he showed me a field of wheat, and I grew up in Illinois and Missouri, and I know what ripe wheat looks like. When ripe wheat is ripe, what happens to the head of the wheat? It drops. And so walk around your malls, walk around your streets, and look at the people with their heads down. They're ready. But they're not going to come into your church, most of them. They can't. Now, some of them will, here in the South, but many of them can't. They just can't make that transition. We saw that in our community. We had Hispanics and people that were impoverished in our community. We moved down into the barrio for the purpose of winning those people. We were having a terrible time. We'd win them to Christ, but we couldn't get them in our church. So finally, one of the young men said, why don't we make a church for them? I thought, duh. That's so obvious. And so he started what he calls the Lamb's Lunch. And he said, these people, they're homeless by and large. Some of them have, they live in a semi-transient situation. They can afford motels and things when they double and triple up in families. So part of the month they're in a motel, part of the month they're in a state park, part of the month they're in a car, and sometimes they're sleeping on the ground. Depends on what part of the month it is and where they are economically at that time. And so our guys were working with them all the time, and I said, tell me where the penetration ought to be. Every market has a point of penetration, a point of felt need. And he said, it's for the children. They're all sick over the educative loss for their children. They're sick over the clothing for the children, for the lack of dental care, for the lack of any number of things. They feel worse about their children than they do about themselves. And I said, okay, let's set up a ministry for the children. And so they came up with one called the Lamb's Lunch. They started that ministry about a year ago with three kids. They average about 1,200 now on Saturday in the Lamb's Lunch. The Lamb's Lunch has seen hundreds and hundreds of converts. We've seen many people rehabilitated and brought back into the working market or back in homes. Many of them are now at church on Sunday. But hundreds of them aren't and never will be. And they ought not to be. We've planted six churches out of the Lamb's Lunch to date. Are you hearing me? But they're not churches like the church you'd go to or I would go to. They're churches that are different. But they're churches that meet the needs of those folks. They're churches that are culturally approximate. They're their churches. Their services are different. Their services last almost 5 hours. You know why? Because part of it is they have to do the food bagging of the food. That's part of it. Then they have to do the cooking. And then they have to dance for a while because that's part of the culture. So they dance and sing, and we have hirachi bands, and we have, you know, and they have just a big party. And it lasts about 5 hours. And that's a normal church service for them, and anything less than that, they feel cheated. And everybody from the smallest baby to the oldest grandma to the biggest dog comes. That's the truth. And sometimes opposing gangs are there, and then we have violence, you know, and that's part of the culture too. I used to play in Mexican weddings. I never went to a Mexican wedding they didn't have some fights. That's part of the deal. So when they gather, they have some fights. Now most of you wouldn't program that into your order of worship. Mean that there's violence every time they get together, but there's potential for violence every time because it's in the culture. It's the way they think about gathering and being a people. Do you understand? And we have to minister to who they are, not who we want them to be. I want to talk to you for 10 minutes about change. As I mentioned earlier, I've been lecturing as a adjunct professor at Fuller for 16 years, and I've been doing a lecture on change, being a change agent for that period of time. So I know a little bit about change. It's field tested. Fear is a natural outcome of change, particularly change that they don't get any input into or control over. And so it's very important that if you decide that you want to bring change, you know, Bob was talking about 330 degree. I'd say 103 degree would be better. For some of your churches, honestly. Change slowly, change personally as over against professionally. Now let me talk to you about change the way I understand it. And again, I've worked with lots of churches, lots of different kinds of churches, and there's some things that I think ought not be done. I would not change anything on Sunday morning. If I was going to bring change, you know, if I was in one of your churches, maybe I was in the First Assembly of God Church of the such and such, I don't know what your churches are, but if you mentioned Pentecostalism earlier, I wouldn't change anything on Sunday morning. That's the last thing I'd mess with. Keep in mind, it works sort of like this. Orthodoxy and orthopraxy. 92% of the people are tuned into what you do. 8% are tuned into what you believe about what you do. Listen to me. You start messing with what they do, and immediately the symbols get clear. You begin signaling them very clearly. Change is here. Okay? So don't mess with Sunday. I mean, it's just sheer idiocy to go home and bless God. We're gonna. You know? And I've seen guys preach that way. They go off to a conference and somebody says, back in, remember in the 70s, get a bus, that's the secret to success. And I'm a church consultant, I'm going across the country, I saw thousands of rotting buses. I mean, I'm not exaggerating, thousands of rotting buses sitting behind, because back in 71, they went to the Chicago such and then, and you know, such and such said, if you had a bus ministry, you can do that. So I want to bring healing into our church. will you come and do a conference on healing at our church? I said, no way. You know, I said, I can't afford the blood and neither can you. This was a very liberal church that, you know, had a very visible position in the denomination back a few years, built a huge edifice, now about a third full, you know, and Dr. such and such had been there, and Dr. such and such, and now it wasn't doctor anymore. You know, they couldn't afford doctor next. Now, when you think of it negatively, you say, that's a hard group to change. And you think of it another way, that's a good group to practice healing on. So I had to ask some questions, because see, some of these things are prescriptively put together. You can't sell over-the-counter medicine on every situation. I'm in a Methodist church. Oh, 68 years of age, huh? So I had to find that out. So I asked him a few questions. Tell me about your church, the history, the back. I said, you've got to build small groups in your church. He says, oh, I can't get people in small groups. I said, that's right. Older people do not like small groups. He says, I can't do it. I said, no, wait, you don't understand. You already have small groups. He says, what do you mean? I said, you told me earlier, you have 22 committees in your church. And they did. And he was on every one of them. You wonder what he did all month long? And so he said, what do I do? And I said, when you go home, make hi, how are you a question. That doesn't mean pray about you. That means pray on you. He said, oh, they'd feel funny in our church. Sure they are. I said, they will the first few times. But just do it anyway. Do it quickly. Don't make a big deal out of it. Don't make any big promises. Don't put on some sort of an attitude. Don't start speaking in King Jamesism. Oh, the, you know, be stuff like that. Just say, Lord, you know, here's my brother. His back really hurts today. Touch him, God. And that's it. He says, is that all there is to it? So the headaches went away. You know, and other things didn't happen. You know, pretty soon, I said, start tearing pages out of books. Share it with this guy. Share it with that guy. You know, get a chapter here or there. Write an article. Don't preach it from the pulpit. Bring change in very slowly. Then I said, begin looking for their children and grandchildren and start having parties for them. And he says, what do you mean? I said, look. It, by the way, this would have been very easy in a Hispanic or an Italian culture. But it was very hard in the culture he was in because of the way they view elderly. But see, in a Hispanic or an Italian culture, they love honoring the older people. And so having a party for, you know, Papa such and such is a big deal. And they can get everybody off of that. I know a guy in Long Island, Staten Island, that's built a huge church that way, just constantly winning people to Christ. Beautiful work of God, built around the culture and its natural interaction, the way it naturally relates. So they love to get together and they love to talk big about one another. So he lets them do that, and then he just puts Jesus in there. And has one of the granddaughters get up and give her testimony. He's telling me about winning one of the mafia people there. That old man was sitting there and the tears were running down his face. Led him to the Lord about a month later. You see, the entree, that's his heart, that's his grandchild there. He loved what was going on in his life. So, go back to the Methodists. And so I said to him, introduce it by doing it. You see, you are the change agent. They will do what you do. They'll do what you do, not what you say to do, but what you do. Years ago, when we were worn out Pharisees, and we had a Bible answer to everything, Bob. And I really witnessed to that this morning. We did. We had an answer to everything. Anything we didn't have an answer to wasn't worth knowing. And we would tell you that. Oh, don't bother about that. That's not important. Here's what's important. And but we were just burned out on it. We were dry as dust. We knew everything, but we couldn't like each other. Couldn't hardly get together. We were so prickly and so stinking mean. Trained to talk bad about everybody. I haven't gotten over that yet. I still lapse into that from time to time, and this, it breaks the Father's heart and breaks mine too, because it just comes out in me. It's just entrained in me. So I don't think I have to stop and repent, because I did that last week. So my point is this, is that you're working with the people, and you're bringing them along, and you bring them along by what you do more than what you tell. But there is a point where you have to tell them. what Jesus both began to do and tell, Acts 1:1. And so there's a point in which you must give an explanation. And that point came in our own church as we were a bunch of worn-out, pharisaical legalists, conservative evangelicals, and I remember people trying to raise their hand in a worship service. Oh, that was painful. Still painful for me. I still can't do it. It just shuts me down to be in a setting where everybody's open and having a good time. But I just close up, get quieter and quieter. Can't make it yet, you know. Still working on it. I hope to before I go to heaven, because I understand they do it all the time up there. But in the as the church grew in its acumen, you see, we started seeing some healings. We started seeing people empowered by the Spirit, baptized in the Spirit. We saw people being released, and then they said, well, what is this? You taught against this in the past. And I said, well, I think I was wrong. You know, but let me show you this. This is something I've been reading. Or let me give you this chapter out of this book. Or read such and such. That was really helpful to me. And so just by pointing them to sources and feeding them on the basis of their hunger, as over against cramming it down their throats, saying, you need to know this so that we can move ahead, because bless God, you're stopping the cause of God among us. That won't get it. I believe that there's a great harvest being prepared, and it's being prepared among the poor. But why by the poor, I do not only mean those that are the jetsam and the flotsam of society, those that are homeless and incapable of functioning and uneducated and economically deprived. We live now in a nation that's largely fatherless. And all about us, there are literally hundreds of millions of people who have grown up in households that have been dysfunctional, to use the current popular term. And so we have a nation of people that don't know who they are, they don't know what they're all about. They've got all kinds of shiny, glittery things, and there's no happiness in it. And they're impoverished, they're poor in spirit, and they're broken. Now, some of them are still so excited about the glitter and the glamour and the new thing they got, that their heads aren't down. But you walk around the streets of your communities and you'll see those heads down. And if you go and minister to those folks, you're going to find a ready, receptive group for the gospel. They may not be the group for you to land, but you can land them somewhere. You can find a church or make a church that they can go to. And as you start doing that, you'll see an impact on your community and on your culture. 3.5 years ago, our church went to its lowest ebb. During that period of time, I had had a heart attack just prior to that in 85. I went through a lot of difficulties with lots of issues. I was spiritually deceived by something the enemy had put together, in which he told me that I was to give my church up and to walk away from it, and it was wrong, it was a lie. The Lord showed me that. But in 1987, we only had 52 converts baptized. Now, for some churches, that would be a lot, you know, in a year's time, to have 52 baptized converts. But for us, that was just absolute miserable failure. And I was so broken over it. But sometimes, you see, we need these quantifiable measurements to see where you really are. And I was looking at it. We'd only spent about $6,000 on the poor that year. You know, all we had an international reputation. We grew 2,000 people that year. We were put in some magazine as one of the fastest growing churches in America. I was sick. I almost vomited when I read the article. Not because the man that wrote it was wrong, but because it was so dishonest. We weren't the church. I didn't want to go to that church. I didn't want to be part of that people. And then I realized whose fault it was they were in the condition they were. And so I had to repent. Now, God has turned that around. Last year, we gave out over 1 million meals in Anaheim. We had over 1,700 baptized converts. This year, it'll be considerably larger than that. God is stirring us again. We're planting churches again. We're ministering again. God is causing us to flourish. The people are studying the Word again. The people are growing. The small groups are growing. By every measurement I know how to measure us, except one, which has to do mainly with Bible study. I think we're biblically ignorant in our church. And how we've gotten that way, I don't know, but again, it probably comes back to me somewhere. I'm probably not doing enough Bible teaching. And my point in saying that is simply this. There is a market out there, and we're testing that market for you. And I tell you, there are literally hundreds of thousands of people in America that are hungry for God right now. And later, you know, tomorrow, I want to show you empirical proof that revival has started in America. I'm absolutely convinced it's underway. But let's just close and give you a little break time before dinner. Father, thank you for these, your people. And we ask, oh God, you'd richly bless them and strengthen them in their understanding of who they are and what they're for. And Lord, give them eyes to see the harvest that's all about them.